Correspondence, No Coast Podcast, Episode 1.
Ooh.
Beatrice?
I just called you Beatrice.
And that
nice.
Your I don't name. Care if that is your real name.
It might be.
You don't even know the Wasky lyrics, dude.
I'm okay with that.
Yeah, it's okay.
I'm Kelly Betts.
Pompey. Fuck your DJs, not me.
Co-host to the right, Caper Lucero.
.bandcamp.com.
Right.
What we're doing is breaking down, event by event, what's happened.
Yes, because of the tremendous public outcry we've had to do posthumous recaps of our last 3 years of events, we're going to do that. But I think this will be really fun for you and me both.
Yes.
You get to live in the past with us.
Yeah. And, you know, this is, you're going to hear all sorts of insider stuff from the, you know, the people who threw it. A lot of stuff that's not on the footage. You're going to find out, like, some really interesting footage you might not have been able to check out at the time, you know. And as I said before, this is for Heebs.
What's up, Heebs? Yo, so, let's see. War and Peace Park 1 happened in early July of 2009. It was our very first No Coast event. We came up with the name No Coast just to help brand this event. I think we could start there. The name No Coast, really briefly, I stole from a graffiti crew turned name of venue that I was involved in starting and helping run. There was a DIY venue.
So you're not even really stealing.
Not really stealing. There was a DIY venue, like a punk venue, that had like a little library in it. And we did shows and readings. And I would do actually like folk shows there. And I think we had one or two rap shows there. But that was called The No Coast. And I wanted to like have a feel of the roots and like an awareness of what was going on in the scene and carry over those DIY ethics. And so I called the league No Coast. And I'm really lucky that I was like, you know, when naming the YouTube channel, it was No Coast Battles. I remember looking at it written, No Coast Battles. And I was like, what if someday we make a song or two? You know, like, what then? What then? If we ever move on. So thank God. The name for everything, like the official name for us is No Coast Raps and not No Coast Battles. So left that little breathing room, and it's really come in handy because now I don't give a fuck about battles, and I'm just making music. I just do this on the side.
Still give a fuck about battles.
I kind of give a fuck.
All right. I give a fuck about, like, Carter Deems and, like...
Real talk, I got respect for Carter Deems, Vesh, and that's it.
Yeah.
And Righteous.
Yeah.
And righteous. Yeah. He's, you know, he's serious with those bars.
He's a lyrical Sean Penn.
Can we
shout
that? Oh, yeah, that's it. And shout out to our green screen. We're here at Columbia Access Studios, Cat TV Studio B in downtown Columbia, Missouri. Our beautiful home. Except for Ray, who drove in all the way from Chicago just to do this.
From Chicago.
Como to Chi-Town, windy is the city.
That's right. So, yeah, man. We wanted to go over the judges of our wonderful event.
First the host.
Oh, first the host.
Good idea, Caper.
Why don't you tell us a little bit about the host? All right, you weren't there, so your perception on camera.
Let's break it down as a existential viewpoint of the whole event itself. Cooper, our homeboy, Cooper.
Cooper Lee.
This is the first No Coast event. It was in Peace Park. It's a park downtown. They had... You guys' first attempt was great. It's hilarious. I loved it. I loved every battle. But the host was just horribly awesome in every way you can imagine. And he's my homie, but like, you guys must have literally just been like, here, wear these sunglasses and this fake gold chain, and it'll solidify you.
Was that part of the Mod Vintage sponsorship going on? Is
that
like we were just accessorizing ourselves at random? Like,
yeah, well, the
later it actually started fitting
right.
Well,
what happened? What later happened it made was sense. I got to defend my friend here, like, and because I dressed him up and I gave him the sheet of paper that he's reading off of the whole
you
time.
You even made him
he's
held
reading
that piece
off
of paper.
A big sheet of paper.
Blue line.
You kept him up all night the last night too.
I was not there for him. He did not sleep the night before. Part of the problem, maybe. So we go into Mod Vintage, who'd offered us a sponsorship. They're still our friends. They're still sponsor our events. They're a vintage clothing store, a trend vintage clothing store, I think is what you're supposed to call it. And they're also a costume shop. And now they let me wear whatever I want, and they occasionally give me some free gear. But back then, they were only comfortable putting us in costumes. And so we had to pick out a costume. So he's literally wearing a rapper costume. And so
tonight, like he wears his rap costume.
Scrawny white boy, scrawny white, like 20-something, in a gold chain, like a big fake gold chain, and a shirt that says Black Licorice.
I kind of thought he just came like that. Now I understand.
It was my fault. Totally my fault.
Black Licorice.
Yeah. And just didn't have anybody's name memorized. Like, you know, only knew like two of the people that were in it. Kind of, he wasn't watching battles. We were watching battles, and so he kind of doesn't understand the whole format. The worst thing, and this is also my fault, is I don't know, for some reason, it was to mimic the freestyle tournament style. It was like, you in a freestyle tournament, you do two rounds, and then if it's really close, you do a third round. The third round is the overtime. And what they were doing in grind time was they would do three rounds, and then you would vote for the OT, which was the fourth round. Neither of which really makes sense, but we decided to combine those... And just have an ultimate just like shitstorm of nonsense where everybody wrote three rounds, they did two, and then Cooper would be like, "Judges, I want to see a third round. What do you think?"
You totally like.
And so every battle has three rounds, but at the end of the second, there's this little awkward fake. We're doing a third round, right? You know,
a couple
like,
of the
you
battles.
You guys want to see the third?
Well,
round?
Well, you versus D Sharp. He thought that was like the end of the battle after two rounds.
No, then, after a round and a half.
Oh, that's right. Yeah, no, because he tried to like, because he was doing the thing where he was like trying to call it and then be like, "I don't know, guys. Another round, overtime."
Also, my great fault. Footage moments.
Also,
too.
My fault. I probably told them to build the tension. I'm like, you know, make sure it's
he's
dramatic,
definitely
you know,
going off of like
sure
some,
it looks totally natural.
Yeah. There's a fake acting element to it,
right?
You know, that
but,
comes
but,
up.
But another thing, that element in there was like at this time, you know, YouTube clips could not be anywhere near as long as they can.
Oh,
we're still
the
10-minute limit.
Yeah.
It wasn't even to the 15 limit, which was like the skies parting when they made
right.
15
yeah.
for us, because then you could get a good battle in it. But like,
right.
yeah, we've got like even 3-round battles that get end up getting split into two videos for
right.
some of the earlier ones. And the grind time videos, yeah, they would do that third, that fourth round OT as the second video. But yeah, basically, imagine yourself like you've never even seen an acapella rap battle,
and
someone's like, "Hey, you should host this thing that I just told you about," and and you haven't slept. And by the way, wear this chain. Like, imagine how you would act. And you can see our poor boy Cooper.
He was one of the best rappers
I knew, by the way, at that time.
Yeah,
he was
real.
A real dope rapper and dope producer.
Yeah, man.
He was holding a lot.
He's got one of my.
He
one
still
of the tracks
is a dope
on
producer.
Yeah, for real. Amazing producer. Amazing rapper. I hear he's finally got like a full length coming out soon.
Nice.
But man, I'll play some of Blunts for Lunch, which is possibly the catchiest song to ever come out of Columbia, Missouri, which he did when I was, I think, 15 years old.
15.
When he
yeah.
was 15.
Nice.
Don't do drugs, kid.
Yeah.
So he was. Okay, let's get back to the hosting aspect. And Cooper, dude, you're our homie. It was all Kelly Betts' fault. Like, that's what happened.
Yeah.
But he has you holding a lavalier mic pointed at the rappers.
Right.
So, I mean, and he's holding it, though. It's holding
lavalier,
a clip-on
if you don't
mic.
Know the jargon, lavalier mics are the clip-ons that you're supposed to put on the subject.
So he's holding it, and he's pointing it at, like...
So we have melded, like, boom mics with lavaliers.
Yeah.
And he's
techniques.
Trying to save face, too. I'm sure inside of his mind, he might have been like, "What the fuck am I doing?" But he's like, yeah, like he's into it. You know what I mean? Like he's got to play it off. So they're fucking horribly awesome battles to watch for that. Like the bars are there. There's actually bars. I was rewatching these battles just today. There's bars that I'm like, holy fuck. Like somebody could say that nowadays.
Yeah.
And I would think it was like some dope ass double entendre. But he's holding the lavalier mic and he's obviously ate up because he'd been up all night. You know, but like. And on top of that, he's just like, "I've never even seen one of these battles you fuckers are talking about."
Right.
You know what I mean?
And I guess just like in defense of him and I, it's like that comes from wanting to keep it official and grounded. And like I knew there's people that would have been better on camera maybe, but like it's, you know, he is an amazing rapper and producer and he'd been doing
right.
stuff in town for a long time. So it's like, I'm going to get this guy that's official, you know, that like basically trying to make everything as official as possible. And I really want to briefly touch on, like, if you have a league that you're planning on starting or you're doing one, don't hire a production team to do it for you. Like, somebody you know can work a camera good enough to film a battle.
Yeah.
Like, don't trust anybody else to do it, because it was a whole thing where it took like a month to get these tapes. This guy wasn't hitting me back. It was somebody that I just met at the bar, you know, gave me a card or whatever. Like, yeah, man, like the quality was awful. You know, like it's the sound was all, everything was bad. Had trouble getting it. Had to pay him. You know, like.
But you got the footage in the long run.
Got the footage out. So, yeah, film your own battles. Keep it DIY.
And flipping it a little more positive, man. Like, you know, just think about it from whoever perspective of when they were drinking. They said, oh, yeah, I can do this favor for you, whatever. You're just, if you want one of two things, okay? You want enough money to, like, pay someone who does this professionally their actual rate or close to it to do it, which you don't have if you're an aspiring rap battle league. Right. Or you want someone who you know, who's maybe not professional level, but at least has a vested interest in, like, pushing this thing through, like, is actually sort of part of what you're doing. And it's a better trade-off to get that person who's, like, you know, just your friend who happens to be the least ignorant person on it in the room to just do the best they can on it, who you know is going to, like, come back with it, versus someone who's trying to break into doing this professionally who has just no stake in whether your stuff comes out or not. Because honestly, like, they're busy, they're students, whatever. They just had finals. We have a J school in town, you know, like, and this is, they're just going to be busier than they think they're going to be in a month when they're putting this together for you. So that's the, you know, friends over freebies, basically. If you can't, and if you can afford to pay a professional, yeah, do that. But you know, if you can't, don't expect professional help from non-professionals.
Third option is go to your local access television station, hey, wherever that is.
True story.
This is, ours is CAT, Columbia Access Television. And take the classes that it takes. They're usually, I'm sure they got one of these in every major city, even smaller cities. Our town is 150,000 people when the students are here, and we got one. You probably use all their equipment for free.
Yeah, man. Come to Columbia Access Studios downtown on 10th. It's on North 10th, like across from the funeral parlor.
But you can't start a leak here. We already did.
Yeah, don't do that. But man, like, we're using the studio. Diggy Splash teaches Final Cut projects. Like, he'll teach you how to use Final Cut. And I get to use this camera. Like, I just took a $50 field equipment training seminar, and I get to use this TSI.
For a whole year.
Just check it out whenever I want to. Yeah, it's for like a whole year. So,
yeah. And all the accessories that come
with it. If you're trying to get into media in general, if you're doing music and you want an outlet for it, or if you're trying to get video or take photos, man, public access TV, like, just community resources are there. Don't think you have to buy everything right off the bat yourself. Like, this is just a minor investment. It's a, you know, minor input, major export.
These are great tips, man. So, you know, did we had some, we were judging still back then, right?
Right.
Everything was judged.
Oh, there we go, yeah.
And that was another way in which you actually reached out to the community and, like, try to enhance the credibility. It also gets more people involved in what we're doing.
Totally.
So you had a great mix of, like, scene choices who were just credible enough to do it, right? The judges. I remember there was Dan Friesen, who was the most hilarious judge ever. He was just great. I would have him judge every battle anyone does ever.
The best part of NoCoast's first year of existence was a judge who didn't give a shit. Really,
just watch the ending. Just go right to the end. Watch wait for the guy who looks like Dirtbag Dan, kind of the beard, and you know, this was like, I think Ice Nine won because it sounded like the other guy was on Quaaludes.
Yeah, every judgment he had a good, like, boom, little one-liner.
Yeah, because everybody in hip-hop is all love, you know? It's like, you did your thing, so-and-so did his thing, you did your thing. It's like, some guys didn't do their thing. Like, I don't know what that means, even. But, like, Dan Friesen was the host of the as-yet-unnamed comedy show, and he was you know, one of the most successful comedians in town. He was doing his thing.
He was doing the damn thing.
But he was a relatively accomplished comedian in town and also an event host. We also had Steady P.
Yeah.
Who, as a qualifier on our YouTube description, we put as the winner of Scribble Jam St. Louis Regionals, which is true. Scribble Jam being, at that time, America's biggest freestyle tournament, and a pretty big deal. But what he also was on top of that was an event organizer himself and the host of a weekly hip-hop open mic that featured freestyles called Mad Real Monday.
Yeah, you know, they've got a new posse project. The Underground label has got their first posse album that's just coming out.
Shouts Identity.
Out to them. Yeah, man. Yeah, look Identity. Up Indie Ground. On YouTube and all other media outlets. They
did fire. I've heard some of that.
Naming their name. But yeah, just everybody on there is super talented. They're still going hard. They do their thing.
And we must have had another judge, right?
And the third judge seemed credible at the time.
Was this Bilbo Baggins?
Dr. Awesome. Bilbo Dr. Baggins. Dr. Awesome.
Nice. Backwards Bill.
And yeah. he had won Rhyme or Die, I think, multiple times. I think two times he
late,
won.
Late 90s. He won Rhyme or Die.
Rhyme or Die was like
that was where we got you know all about this. I'm going to let you introduce that context.
If you want to know about Rhyme or Die was like the original battle rap tournaments that were going on in Columbia. We had one every Monday for like man that went on for like I want to say almost 2 or 3 years
probably.
And that was like
I was barely old enough to get in a club too.
No, it was before the year 2000. It was I remember that. Like yeah. I was. 15 years old or like 15 or 16 years old. And just to give you a concept of how long ago this was, we were entering those battles. And when this is a dive bar, I'd enter those battles and I'd go downtown with like $10 and I'd get in for $1. That's how much the charge was. And they had 50-cent fucking
when
beers.
You took me, it already skyrocketed like $5.
Wow. No, that was a different venue because they ended up having to move.
Oh, because Shattered but wasn't a dive
bar. The original dive bar was...
Pure Lounge.
No, at that point it was called Down Under.
Down Under, okay. Yeah. Now we know.
That's how long ago this was. Yeah. But anyway, so like $1 to get in, 50 cent beers, and like the fucking bartenders didn't card anybody. And it was like right downtown, weekly freestyle battle tournaments. I used to enter that shit. I must have entered, I don't even know how many there was. Obviously 50 a year. And they did it for a couple years. I entered every week for like a year. But that was like, I was like 15 or 16 years old back then.
Yeah, and this is like, when you were getting me into hip-hop too at the time. Like, Caper's part of the reason I started really getting more involved and like started DJing and stuff. And you took me to the...
Well, we were 17.
I went to like maybe two of these Rhyme or Die things and you got me to enter like the first time I was there.
Right.
I couldn't even like, I could hardly rap back long. I couldn't rap back then. There was no hardly about it.
No, you had some...
I had, you know...
It was a freestyle battle tournament, and I made him spit his written bars in the tournament.
I blame him.
And I was like, dude, you know, it doesn't matter, man. Just get up there. It's going to be fun.
I mean...
And you had to battle big artists.
I'll say this. Yeah, the dude was the champion. This guy, I didn't know who
he
was.
He won, like, every week.
He won after that. Anyway,
you were having...
And then we went to this
after party. No, I remember your bars.
Yeah.
My rhyme.
Persistence and provision. Yeah.
Okay, I remember one bar was
there was a good Moses line in there.
My rhymes are so old school, they belong in the Smithsonian.
Oh, yeah, yeah. I wrote that later, though. I wasn't quite that.
Yeah. No, you use that
Babylon,
one. Then, right?
The Babylon, like Babylonians. I'm so old school, I belong in the Smithsonian. It was very, like, Eminem B side inspired shit. Like, overdose on clonopin, wake up and make a smoke.
No, but yeah, so that was, like, way back in the day, man. And, like, I don't even know why were we talking about that?
Because we're saying Baggins. Bilbo Baggins.
Bilbo Baggins was the like yeah. Okay.
We'll edit that.
He was he would win also too in those Rhyme or Dies way back.
DC the 6'3".
DC the 6'3" would win.
Who ended up becoming a judge as well.
Yeah.
So we were grounded in the roots, man. Right. You know, like tried to bring everybody from an era where I wasn't even around for. And just listen to who that, you know, find out who that was and bring them in and try to get them involved in No Coast to judge and just to be there.
Yeah, and you round up whatever friends you could to actually battle.
Yeah, and then I talked my friends into battling.
You know, the headliner we already had, you know, is you doing that rematch, that long-awaited rematch, so you can finally beat Daniel Schar.
Right.
But then we had that last, and then whatever else you could scrounge up, right?
So should we go down from...
I said we go up.
Go up? All right, yeah. We'll go up. So... I talked Pompey into doing a battle, even though he was DJ Pompey at the time.
Yeah, I hadn't even taken DJ off my name yet.
Yeah.
So were you like, because I know you'd rapped from like way back in the day. Yeah. So you were like rapping.
I mostly just played around with writing. Like, you probably watched me write the few verses I had written at that time. Like,
I remember I'd write three verses.
Yeah, I'd write like 112 bar verse a year or something, right. Like, you know, and play with it. But mostly, you know, and I could, you know, I would attempt a freestyle. Never really got like more than a couple bars out. But then, you know, but I got into DJing at that time, back in 99, 2000. And I just did that heavy.
Right.
Like in my dorm rooms, whatever. I had like this dorm room I was sharing with people, had turntables underneath my bunk bed, like,
nice.
You know, all this shit. And you're doing that all through college. And, you know, 10 years later, whatever, we comes to start this thing. And I had gotten a little more into it, but mostly I was just sort of DJing for you and Mantra and all that. And but you got me to
not,
like,
not just
battle
for
your
us,
friend.
But like to back us up for the music.
Yeah.
Right. Yeah.
Yeah. Not just in front of you. There's easily like another 15 drunk people watching.
No, man, Mojo's open mic used to be popping.
Oh,
off,
it was
man.
It was actually we I, got I was of that. Very proud to be involved at the peak of that. Like, yeah, dude, we had some really great nights.
Oh yeah, too. And speaking of that, the host of that, as well as what before that, the Blue Fugue open mic was Anna DiAgostino, who was my girlfriend at the time, who was the Time Girl.
Time. So we had UGZ's DJ, DJ Pompey.
Yeah, my
versus,
DJ.
Versus your old friend that I had never even met in person, but you showed me like his picture and told me some stuff about him, and we're like, now go.
Yeah.
We need 360s about
and who
this
was
guy.
That?
That was Donnell. That was Donnell Lauderdale. Donnell, a.k.a. Deez Nuts was his rap name at the time.
A.k.a.
As you can
Medium
tell, Deez. I had no material.
You've seen him. If you've ever watched any no-cuss battles, he's in the background somewhere.
Yeah, like almost every event.
That or a Free Nuts t-shirt.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
He locked up. That's him, by the way. Free Nuts, the t-shirt. That is like...
Yeah.
Deez Nuts.
That's great to explain.
That was my first opponent.
Right. He got locked up for totally nonviolent offenses, and he's completely reformed now, doing excellent, but has a family and shit. But when he was locked up, Free Nuts was our support of him, you know, getting money for him when he was inside. But, yeah, so basically I have my little brother, my DJ, my girlfriend, you know.
Yeah.
Like, keeping it real.
Yeah. But, do we want to talk about the other matches?
No, we should talk about this kettle because it's definitely worth it.
Cool.
Man, Pompey just embarrassed the guy. Destroyed him. Pompey just came out swinging, man. Like, just won
it. Who went first in that one?
He did. Because okay. I had a line that I had
you
to change depending
on who. You didn't even say anything yet. And he was, like, sweating you already.
He really just didn't adapt that well to the format. He's one of those people that has freestyled a lot, but only over beats. And he was not freestyling this time, even though some of it looked like he did. But he really, I don't think he knew how to really adapt to those sort of punchline formats.
Yeah, that's the funny part I want to mention is, like, what he's doing seems like he's just floundering. It sounds like he's just saying whatever is coming to his head. And you would swear that it's freestyle.
I still don't believe that it's written.
When in reality, he showed me after the fact, like that night, he's like, "Oh, I didn't get some of my bars off. I gotta tell you what I
had." I saw
it
too, yeah.
And he like pulled out his sheets of paper.
Yeah, and here, so they call you DJ Pompey, looking like Shrek's friend Donkey. Well, you're fake like Monopoly. You know, like,
and then the closer of like, you smell like cat poop. Written down.
Written.
You smell like cat poop.
Well, there was parts of it where he's like, saying whenever you're freestyling and you say I'm freestyling off the top, not doing pretty good, but when you say those things, there was parts where he was saying that. So are you sure like it was all written?
No, I'm not saying every single word, but all the material that he wanted to get out, he got out.
Okay,
right.
All right.
He stumbled through it a little bit, but yeah.
Because to me it looks like his first two bars, he's like, okay. And then that's when, like, it seems like right after his first two or three bars,
you
GZ
can't beat me because I smoke drugs so discreetly. And if you watch it, you can hear someone be like, "I doubt it." He had the best heckles. They weren't too loud. You had to be listening. They're like, "I doubt it."
No,
like, I doubt you smoke them discreetly.
Yeah,
you're not being very discreet about it right now. What's the implication?
That's ironic. Like in the background.
Yeah.
Anyway, so he basically didn't have that much. But the thing is, they had built this guy up because he was a dope entertainer back when you used to know him as Sullivan or whatever, I guess. And they like basically they tricked me into like preparing like I was gonna battle like Thesaurus. Like I had no idea what he was gonna do. And so like what you're seeing in me versus Deez Nuts, even though
like you wrote for Lux,
I would do better delivery now. But I was like at that time that was the best like material I was capable of doing. And I believe you should always do that. By the way, you should either take a battle where you're gonna come as hard as you possibly can, even if you think it's gonna be a total landslide as a result, or you should just not accept the battle at all. And so I got
or
that
just
right
freestyle.
Unintentionally. I got
No, don't do that.
God. We'll get to that. But, so that ended up working pretty well. I was really happy with the stuff that came out. Like, some of it I still think is really hilarious, even though
it's
kind
like
of
stacked multis,
prototypical. Like, it wasn't as... A lot of it feels very forced construction now, but I still really like the material.
Yeah, definitely. I guess I just wanted to state this publicly because I finally have a chance to do this. One of the funniest texts I've ever gotten was... Pompey has a closer that's commenting on Donnell's job.
Yeah, should I do the? Should I explain more? So there's like I think second round opener or something like that. And it was actually it was one of my early pre-buttles because I was like, he'll probably say something about I'm a programmer. So it's just something like
pre-buttle, by the way, is a rebuttal to what was said that you knew was going to be said, so you might say it whenever they mention it.
Yeah, I'm the pre-buttle king. One day we'll do a this wasn't that good, but we'll do an episode where I just go through, here are all the pre-buttles you thought I freestyled.
Yeah.
Nice.
Which is like, and they're not all you know, written, but at least half the rebuttals you think I'm freestyling, I'm not. And that goes for all the best rebuttalers are like
semi-pre-med. Sure.
You know, that's the way to do it. Anyway, so I said something like, oh, yeah, it was about time someone called me out for being smart. It was a whack bar. But then I said, he's like, well-paid computer programmer. I'm a nail him, cousin. Meanwhile, I'm like, shit, what rhymes with vacuum cleaner salesman? Nothing. And I just, it's one of my best, like, deliveries of that battle, too. I managed to sort of sell it. Nice. You watch it. People really, really dug that. And that's just the line, what rhymes with vacuum cleaner salesman? Nothing.
It's almost like a stop and pause.
Yeah.
So, kind of, except it actually forms a sentence. Yeah.
Right. So I am chilling, just minding my own business, one night later in a weekend evening, and I get the text, backroom wiener tailspin. From Medium D.
Just end of text.
Backroom wiener tailspin.
Line by itself.
So text reply, question marks, you know, and he says, that's what rhymes with vacuum cleaner salesman. Brilliant.
Oh, shit.
Brilliant.
Damn.
That was 2 years later or something?
Yeah, it was years later. Years later.
So you didn't see that.
So as you can see, he's a clever dude. It just doesn't translate to battling.
Yeah.
You know. Someday he'll have like this one track that we all really dig, but it just hasn't happened yet. Keep at it, man.
I thought the reactions in that battle for Ray's bars were really good too.
Yeah, and it was just
Don Quixote.
It was awesome. Yeah. It was awesome because Ray's just like so high energy, and it just translated really well.
It was high energy for Nokos at that time,
right? Like, yeah, right.
You know,
He was no Tucker Booth,
and it seems like yeah. I look at it now and think that I was really low energy, but you're right. It was like a good presence for our state in Peace Park at that time.
And that battle was really important because nobody watching knew what we were doing. Like the only people that knew about Grind Time, even there at the event, were like, you know, me and Ray and Mantra and like D-Shar. Like, no, like
yeah.
it was still like the secret thing.
I don't even think Bill Baggins still doesn't even know what Grind Time is.
And so, like, to have this battle come out, you know, first, where this guy had all his bars down and is delivering them well, and there's jokes in them, and they're stacked multi-syllable rhymes. It was good to set the tone,
right.
And it also set the tone that evening of just body bags, which is a 3-0 victory, like a flawless victory.
Wait.
Yeah. I don't know. Me and D-Shar's battle was
close. I was going to say,
but the other two that followed were just very one-sided.
So the whole event was just bodies. Bodies. It was like a fucking Ujizi
D-Shar. That one was kind of fairly even, actually, I thought. But like, yeah, the rest battle of them were just completely
besides
swept.
Yours.
Yeah. So speaking of which, was the next one Jimmy Spitz and Ice Nine?
Ice Nine, yeah.